Good morning, dear sisters and brothers. Welcome to Daybreak. Yes, every morning is indeed a perfect gift for all of us from our wonderful Creator. We ought to thank and praise Him cheerfully. So let's clap our hands, tap our feet, and sing with the choir in praising and thanking our mighty Savior. That this praise and worship has drawn you closer to an heavenly experience and you're ready for more spiritual nourishment. So sharpen your ears for today's wonderful message for your soul.
Good morning. May the God of love fill your heart with all His love this morning as you listen. What do you call God? People have called God all kinds and all sorts of names. Not in a bad way, in a wonderful way, of course. But what do you call God? You know, Jesus told us there is a way to call and address God. In Matthew chapter 6, verse 9 to 13, he tells us, this is how you should pray and call your God. He tells us, call God Abba, Abba. Did you know that most children utter the first word at around the age of one by the time they celebrate their first birthday? And the vast majority of babies across the world will utter the word ba, abba. That by choice of little infants is the first word they utter. Abba, abba. What do you call God? Do you call him Abba? Abba literally translates into daddy or papa, just like we all do, pa. Abba. Brendan Manning is a spiritual writer, speaker, retreat master, a Franciscan priest. He wrote a lovely little book titled The Father's Fond of Me. There's a nice story he tells us there of an Irish priest who one day took a walk in the afternoon in his rural parish. And just as he was walking, he heard the bells of the Angelus. He stopped, he bowed his head down, took off his hat, made the sign of the cross facing the church, and started to say the Angelus. And just as he did so, he saw an elderly man who was also walking across the road towards him by the church. The old man took off his hat, knelt down in the middle of the road, bowed his head down and began to pray. And as the Irish priest continued to say the Angelus, he kept noticing the other man in the corner of his eye. He saw the love with which he prayed, the passion written large on his face. And after he had finished his own prayer and he had crossed himself, he walked towards the elderly man, still knelt down in prayer. And the man continued to pray, his head bowed down, deep in thought and reflection. So the Irish priest waited for a little while. He waited and he waited. And finally, the man finished his prayer, looked up with a smile towards the church and crossed himself. And then he turned around to see the Irish priest standing. Apologizing to the Irish priest, he got up and he wishes him and says, "Good afternoon, Father. Sorry, I didn't notice you." And the Irish priest says, "Not a problem. How are you doing?" And he says, "Can't be better, Father." And then the Irish priest tells him, "I saw you pray and I was touched and moved." He says, "You must love your God very much." The old Irishman looked at this Irish priest and said, "No, the Father is fond of me." And Brendan Manning writes about this and titles his book, and he says, "The Father is fond of you." When Jesus taught his disciples to pray and he told them to call God Abba, he told them to call God Father, Daddy, Papa, he was telling us to establish a relationship that the Jews were not used to. God for them was Yahweh. God for them was omnipotent, was all-powerful, eternal, everlasting. How could they ever think of God like a kid would call his father? Jesus was telling them, call God Abba just like a little child running around on the street and sees his father coming across and runs up to him and says, Abba, and holds his leg. Call out to God just like a little child would run up to his father, wanting his father to pick him up and hug him and kiss him, crying, Abba. And he tells us, that's our God, that's our Father. A Father who will wait for you to run up to him and pick you up and kiss you and hug you and hold you tight, just like the prodigal son's story, where the father waits for this wayward son who leaves and takes his property and sells it off and goes to an unknown land, does things that's not worth talking about. And when he returns, the father runs up and waits for the son to be embraced in his love. And the scripture tells us the father won't stop loving him. The father won't stop hugging him. The father won't stop kissing him. The father loves him. Abba loves the son. And that's our God. And Jesus tells us, call God Abba. Call God Papa. Call God Daddy. Who's your God? What do you call him? Call him Abba. Jesus told us to. Today, I invite you, you know, as you go about your busy day, Call out to God. Call him out whenever you get a chance. Cry out to him and call him Abba. Ask him to lift you up, to hold you, to pick you up, to caress you, to hug you, to kiss you. Experience the Father's love. Experience the love that God, our Father, has for you. Go be Abba's child and have a wonderful day. God bless you.
Certainly, today's message has given you one or two thoughts to ponder over and reflect upon. Dear brothers and sisters, we are all ordinary people, but we are called to be holy. Saints were ordinary people like you and me. However, they became extraordinary because of their extraordinary desire to lead a holy life. Our church is blessed with several saints. Now, let us have a glimpse of the saint of the day and that the Catholic Church venerates today.
Saint Henry is known as a remarkable saint who was Duke of Bavaria, Germany, and Emperor of the Holy Roman Empire. He was forced to fight one battle after another against rebellious subjects, but occupied himself in reforming the church, selecting able bishops, leading a personal semi-monastic life. He persuaded the Pope to authorize the Creed on Sundays and major feasts. Henry built the Cathedral of Bamberg in Germany, where his saintly wife, Kunigunda, lies buried. Saint Henry, son of Henry, Duke of Bavaria, and of Gisela, daughter of Conrad, King of Burgundy, was born in 972. During his father's exile as a child, Henry was educated by the Bishop of Freising and then studied at the Hildesheim Cathedral. In 995, Saint Henry succeeded his father as Duke of Bavaria. When the new Pope Benedict VIII was elected, upon assuming the chair of St. Peter, however in 1012, he was forced to flee Rome by Gregory VI, an anti-pope. Fleeing across the Alps to Germany, Benedict VIII appealed to Henry II for protection. Henry II agreed to restore Benedict VIII to his papal throne. Near the end of 1013, Henry II gathered his army at Augsburg to march into Italy. Earlier in 1013, Henry signed a peace treaty with Duke Polslaw I of Poland at Merseburg. The peace with Poland gave Henry opportunity to address affairs in Italy. On the march across the Alps, Henry was accompanied by his wife, Queen Kunigunda, and a number of clerics. Upon reaching Pavia, other bishops and abbots joined him. So Henry arrived in Rome in early 1014, restoring Benedict VIII as Pope. On February 14, 1014, the Pope crowned Henry II as Holy Roman Emperor in St. Peter's Basilica. Then, under the presidency of the Emperor and the Pope, the two held a synod in Rome, appointed five bishops, issued decrees against simony and promoting chastity within the clergy, and ordered the restitution of church property. Shortly afterwards, the emperor moved north again, where he established the Diocese of Bobbio. Celebrating Easter in Pavia, Italy, Henry then returned to Germany in mid-May 1014. He left the rule of Rome to the Pope, and thereafter rarely intervened in the politics of Italy or the Papal States. Firmly anchored upon the great eternal truths, which the practice of meditation kept alive in his heart, he was not elated by this dignity and sought in all things the greater glory of God. He was most watchful over the welfare of the church and exerted his zeal for the maintenance of ecclesiastical discipline through the instrumentality of the bishops. Circumstances several times drove the holy emperor into war, from which he always came forth victorious. He had several victories over his enemies, both at home and abroad, but he used his victorious power with great moderation and clemency. He led an army to the south of Italy against the Saracens and their allies, the Greeks, and drove them from the country. The humility and spirit of justice of the saint were equal to his zeal for religion. He cast himself at the feet of Herbert, Bishop of Cologne, and begged his pardon for having treated him with coldness on account of a misunderstanding. He wished to retire into a monastery, but obeyed the advice of the Abbot of Verdun and continued as emperor. Both he and Kunigunda had taken mutual vows of celibacy because of their piety. Henry II also strongly enforced clerical celibacy. The saint made numerous pious foundations, gave liberally to pious institutions, and built the Cathedral of Bamberg. Henry II supported service to the church and promoted various monastic reforms. In May 1017, Empress Kunigunda, while staying at the imperial estates, became seriously ill. Henry vowed to found a monastery on the site if she recovered. Following her recovery in 1018, Henry ordered construction of the Coffingen Abbey. Following Henry II's death in 1024, Kunigunda retired to the abbey, where she remained until her own death in 1040. Returning to Germany to celebrate Easter after a trip to southern Italy, Saint Henry fell ill in Bamberg, Bavaria. After celebrating Easter, Henry retired to his imperial palace. He died there on the 13th of July, 1024, at the age of 52 years, after suffering from a chronic painful illness. Henry had been working with the Pope to convene a church council to confirm his new system of imperial ecclesiastical relations before he died, leaving this effort unfinished. Empress Kunigunda arranged for her husband's body to be buried at the Bamberg Cathedral. Though he left the empire without significant problems, Henry II also left the empire without an heir. Their marriage being childless, the Saxon dynasty of the Ottonians died with Henry. Henry II was canonized in July 1147 by Pope Blessed Eugenius III. His spouse Kunigunda was canonized on the 29th of March 1200 by Pope Innocent III. His relics were carried on campaigns against heretics in the 1160s. During his lifetime, Henry II became an oblate, a layperson who is part of a religious community of the Benedictine order, and today is venerated within the order as one of the patron saints of all oblates. Let us pray. Lord, you filled Saint Henry with your love and raised him from the cares of an earthly kingdom to eternal happiness in heaven. In the midst of the changes of this world, may his prayers keep us free from sin and help us on our way toward you. Grant this through our Lord Jesus Christ, your Son, who lives and reigns with you in the Holy Spirit, one God, forever and ever. Amen. Let us remember in our prayers this day our elders. Lord, we pray that the church and society may respect the wisdom and experience of older people. Jesus, let us see in their faces your face and continue to love them and include them in our family activities, celebrations, and daily life. Let them know they are loved and give them peace. We ask this through the prayers of our Mother Mary. Amen.
After listening to the life and holiness of the saint, let's also resolve to renew our life and decide to lead a saintly life. Dear brethren, Word of God is the light and life for us. It is the food for our soul. So let us now get ready for our spiritual food through daily bread.
Let me first read the passage and then reflect on it. Behold, I send you out as sheep in the midst of wolves. So be wise as serpents and innocent as doves. Beware of men, for they will deliver you up to councils and flog you in their synagogues. And when you will be dragged before the governors and kings for my sake, to bear testimony before them and the Gentiles. When they deliver you up, do not be anxious how you are to speak or what you are to say. For what you are to say will be given to you in that hour. For it is not you who speak, but the Spirit of your Father speaking through you. Brother will deliver up brother to death, and the father his child, and children will rise up against parents and have them put to death. And you will be hated by all for my name's sake. But he who endures to the end will be saved. When they persecute you in one town, flee to the next. For truly I say to you, you will not have gone through all the towns of Israel before the Son of Man comes. This is the word of the Lord. Praise the Lord. Dear friends, the passage given to us for reflection today is really frightening and very undiplomatic way of Jesus presenting. No leader would ever say such a thing if he expects people to follow him. But Jesus is telling something very blunt and very plain. And this has been the story, the history of the church from the founder, Christ, to today. We know the church was born on the cross. The founder of Christianity, the Son of God, was put to death. And it is from his blood the church has risen. So right from the beginning, persecution is somehow a part and parcel of the good news Jesus has preached. And Jesus is giving a warning. You should be aware whom you are following. You should be aware what you have to expect. He doesn't make any false promises. He gives us them warning, and this warning had been very, very true from the beginning to today. And today it would seem more than ever. The persecution against the Christians. If you want to follow Jesus, if you want to live as Christ wanted to live, you are bound to face persecution. Why? Because the Christian life somehow questions the worldly values. Jesus was presented as a sign of contradiction. When Simon, the old man who recognized the child Jesus as the Messiah, after making all the praise and promises, tells one thing: this child is going to be a sign of contradiction. He is laid for the rise and fall of many in Israel. He will be a sign that will be contradicted. And that sign of contradiction is the sign of the cross. And Christianity is so tied to the cross that cannot get out of it. Because it questions. It questions whatever the value, whatever the world values. So a new vision, a new value system has entered into this world that is questioning, that denying, negating the values. The values of self-sufficiency, the values of wealth, the values of power, pleasure, prestige. This is not Christian values. And Jesus stands there. And because of that, because Jesus is giving value to every individual human being, saying every human being is bearing the face of God and everyone is given a chance to be a child of God, irrespective of caste, irrespective of creed or profession, whatever. So the human nature is being transformed into the divine. The humans are given the chance to become children of God, and every child of God has to be respected. And this brings the new vision and brings the crisis. And Jesus says, if you want to follow me, you should be ready to face this persecution. And this is going to create real trouble, friction, and maybe division in the world, and going to the very root of the society, in the very family. So when someone accepts Jesus as the Master and the Lord, when he receives the kingdom, the values of the kingdom, that can even cause trouble in the family that we are seeing today, how children are being massacred by parents or parents being persecuted by children. And we don't have to go farther into the history. What is happening today? The papers are telling much more persecution is happening today than before a century and everywhere. Why? Because Jesus brings in a new vision of humanity, a humanity based on faith in God the Father, who accepts everybody as children and asks to share. You are equals. And that's what the main values of the kingdom is, that you are brothers and sisters of each other responsible for the other. Respect the other as yourself. The equality of rights, equality of humanity, and the dignity of every human person whether irrespective of color and gender. So the kingdom making its inroad into the society can threaten the powers that are basing themselves on such distinctions of color and sex and creed and caste. So we should not be amazed, we should not be surprised if we are being persecuted in the name of the gospel, in the name of Jesus Christ. That's what it is. The Christ and the cross is a negation of much of the values that are so egotistic, worldly, the values of love. And ultimately, there's only one thing. We are all children of God. And Jesus has asked us to love one another as he has loved us. And he has promised that all this persecution will not be able to destroy us. Don't be afraid of those who can kill your body, but be afraid of the one who can put you to hell. That is denying God, giving away from God. So let us ask the Lord for the grace to understand, to accept even persecution when it comes for the sake of Christ, for the sake of the kingdom of God. Heavenly Father, we thank you for this great warning, but also give us the strength to remain faithful to you and to the kingdom. We pray all those people who are under persecution because of their faith in Christ. We also pray for those who persecute the Christians because of their lack of knowledge. Convert their hearts, open their eyes to see what is at stake here, that you are entering into our lives, into our history through Christ our Lord. Amen. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen.
Certainly, today's Daily Bread has given you new insights to follow in your spiritual journey. As we come to the end of this episode of Daybreak, let's once again praise the Lord with this beautiful hymn. That the last half an hour has really been a blessing to you. Till we meet again, stay blessed.